my dears. Today we are going to talk about yet another thing that people typically discuss in direct correlation with autism and ADHD, but is also very much its own thing. And I say this particularly because, as I've said in other videos, the neurodivergent community has a tendency to collect all neurodivergencies as things under the ADHD and autism umbrella, and not only does that make people without ASD and an ADHD diagnosis feel kind of alienated from the community if they only have one of the lesser neurodivergencies, but it also makes people outside of the community not believe their diagnoses when not in conjunction with autism and ADHD, which is just not the case because they do exist. There is often an overlap, but they can be very separate things. Kind of like how 33% of people with ADHD also have dyslexia, but dyslexia is also just as real and valid in non-ADHD people. If that makes sense, great. Okay, so the thing that we're talking about today, which you can probably tell from the title of this video because you were theoretically literate, is proprioception issues, particularly developmental coordination disorder, which I will also call DCD in this video, and dyspraxia. Now, half the sources I read said that these two disorders are the exact same thing, and the other half said that they are slightly different. I'm not sure what the deal is with that, but as far as I can tell, they are functionally identical. It's just like a little diagnostic semantic situation, and those are stupid, so I'm just going to use them interchangeably. So anyway, what is dyspraxia? Well, according to Google, dyspraxia, DCD, are defined as a general difficulty or inability to effectively use motor abilities in a range of environments, which is, more specifically, struggles with fine motor skills such as balance, agility, writing, learning new movements, or predicting the effects of their movements. These conditions are often identified by a general clumsiness above the perceived average for people of a similar age, which includes having no idea how much pressure you're applying to things, like grabbing things too hard when taking objects from others, hugging people so hard that they can't breathe, holding hands too hard so then they're in pain, stepping on people's feet and not noticing, etc., etc., and being atypically clumsy. And no, I'm not going to say abnormally because that word has some not so nice connotations. But anyway, this also includes walking funky and needing to watch your feet as you walk up and down the stairs, having terrible depth perception. Did anybody struggle with driving because of that? Just me. And space perception, i.e. walking into things, being unable to walk in a straight line, being very terrible with personal space / touching others without realizing it, sitting on the edge of chairs and falling off of them, tripping over air and moving too fast or too slow, which often makes balance wonky. Also being terrible at hand-eye coordination and not knowing how to activate muscles without being explicitly taught how to. And this often connects with chronic pain, hypermobility, speech impediments, and vestibular dysfunction, which is balance issues and vertigo and all that good stuff. Also issues with temperature regulation and processing. Now, obviously you don't need to have all of these things in order to be dyspraxic, and conversely, dyspraxics don't experience all of these things necessarily. For example, dyspraxic people can be incredible at dancing or basketball or juggling, but it's estimated that 6 to 10% of children have some features of dyspraxia, or at least enough to have it diagnosed. Well, also adults, because you don't grow out of these things, but whatever. Moving on. You can probably imagine what this might look like for the life of a child, but let's paint a fun picture in your mind anyway. You ready? So you know that thing in gym class? You know how gym class exists, right? So you know when you're forced to exercise in front of your entire class, and a lot of times they make people pick teams, and you always struggle with everything, and so you get picked last because you have proprioception issues, but you don't quite know that at the time because you're just a small child, so you just think you're defective. Because that's spicy and fun and does wonders for the child's self-esteem. I'm being sarcastic, this is sarcasm. Why does gym class exist? But also, this expands a bit to my theater training now, actually, because it's all physical stuff, and it often takes me about twice as long to learn a lot of the movements than it does for the average person. And again, to any of my future employers who may be watching this, once I figure it out, I am a great dancer. I just flounder on the first day, study the heck out of it at home that night, and then I get it perfect the next day, and from then on, I just get overwhelmed really easily with physical stuff because I'm used to being terrible at it, even though I'm significantly better at it than I actually think that I am and also than I used to be. But anyway, the point that I'm trying to make is that this kind of stuff can really mess with somebody's self-esteem, and people don't really think about it as a part of accessibility. So just keep that in mind if you're going to be teaching dance or physical education or anything else like that. Maybe pick teams instead of having the kids pick them, and avoid having games where everybody is relying on one person to win it. I honestly don't know enough about physical education to give any better or more constructive ideas. Anybody who does know these things, I probably have at least one viewer who knows these things. You are welcome to start a thread in the comments with your advice and whatnot on how to make things more accessible. I would love to see that happen. Now, much like many other neurodivergencies, dyspraxia is rarely diagnosed because doctors don't believe us. Shocking, I know. But if you are able to get a diagnosis, or at least a diagnosis for something else that can get you a referral to physical, speech, and/or occupational therapy, therapists specifically trained to work with autistic people can be super beneficial in helping to make life a little bit easier. Not that these traits are inherently bad, but they can be disabling and frustrating and painful and get in the way sometimes. Also, not all these therapies are covered by insurance all the time, so that's also simply not helpful, but it is something to keep in mind if you are interested. But the moment I know that you've all been waiting for, here are some of my funny proprioception errors. I once forgot how hands work, and I cracked an egg directly onto my skirt while baking. Twice. In a row. I walk directly into doors and walls on an almost daily basis, though now my skirts are wide enough that I'm doing a better job at that than I used to be because I bounce off. I don't know how to walk in a straight line, but to be fair, I can't do anything straight because I'm really gay. I once thought that I was holding somebody's hand lightly, and apparently I was crushing all of their bones. I say once, that happens a lot. Sometimes I fall over, just standing. For some reason. Those are the only ones that I can remember right now, unfortunately, but I would love to hear your experiences because I'm sure that you have some wildly entertaining stories as well. I am all for making light of struggles. I think it's a fun way to cope. So do let me know about those in the comments as well. That's all I have for today. As always, thank you for listening. Thank you for learning. Remember, your story isn't over. It has only just begun, and I look forward to seeing you in the— Oh, wait. I have a new single out that came out last week, and it's gonna be linked here. Anyway, back to the other thing. I look forward to seeing you in the next one.